two exams, both will be take-home. Then I have two projects and a final. The nature of the course is such that it requires teamwork. So what I will do, I will divide the class according to the roster to teams of 3, 4, and then I want you to do all the homeworks as a team, but submit individually. So do it, work on it as a team, but prepare your own homework solution that you could, so you would submit that. And of course, there are some logistics all stated in the syllabus. You do it on the engineering pad or graphic or whatever. The other important things are, as I said, the exams and the projects. As you know, there is 15% of the grade is for the lab. As far as the rest of it, 10% is for the homework. Exams, all exams and projects altogether, 50%, and then a final comprehensive, which is 25%. And to be candid with you, I have to be honest, final, last time I taught this course was also take home, because the reason, the thing is, the nature of the course is such that I can, of course, give you maybe one in-class exam, but it would be very basic, simple stuff. So it's not possible to do basically to test you on everything you learn. So I prefer take home, practices. Any questions you may have? Yes.
Have you already decided the teams?
Not yet.
Is it possible we could choose our own or not?
Good question. In the past, I did that, but it became kind of messy. Asking people just send me the names and so on. So I thought the easier way, just go by the roster every five or four, whatever, depending on how many are in each class. I'll assign a team number, and then I'll send you, of course, the list. Any other questions? No? Yes?
So do we have in those teams?
It's a good idea because especially with the projects, comes with the projects. It's up to you. I will identify the teams. If you don't want to be part of it, that's fine. You're gonna do be evaluated individually anyway. So no. Yes?
Do we have the same teams all year?
Yes, because it should be consistent, especially when it comes to projects and so on. And I assure you, I find a way that each person will be evaluated based on his or her own merits. Any other questions? Okay, if not, let's start. Okay, so today I'm just going to, as you can imagine, give you an overview. Okay, so what is mechanical vibrations? Which, of course, there is another name to it, structural dynamics. By the way, have you purchased a textbook yet? Or have you seen a textbook? Yes, there is a reason for that, because I'm not going to force you to buy a textbook. There's a very good textbook, okay? Mechanical Vibrations by Rowe, I believe his first initial is S. The sixth edition just came out. I'm going to use a fifth edition. Not much of a difference actually with that and the sixth edition. The huge difference is, if you want to buy the sixth edition, which is only available in print, you would have to pay something like $285. The fifth edition, which is almost identical, you can download it, full PDF, online, at no cost. That's why, you just have to Google it. Okay, and find it. Easy to find, I can assure you. So that's the one I use. All the homeworks and so on are from that book. So it's by Prentice Hall. I'm sure, Prentice Hall doesn't like that, but it's available, okay? All right, so that's the book that I'm gonna be using.
Is there any reason at all to keep this then?
That's a, definitely Inman.
Yes.
A great book, is a good friend, Dan, is a terrific book, especially that's one of the few books that uses both controls and vibration combined. That's a great reference, that I can tell you. That's a very good book. But Rao is a much more comprehensive book. And of course, I know both of them, but Dr. Rao wrote one of the earliest books in vibrations, and I guess it's now 7th edition or 6th edition. It has a lot of good MATLAB examples and whatnot. So with that said, let's see, what is mechanical vibration? So that's what I tried to give you, a sort of the global picture today. Mechanical vibrations is a field within the broad field of engineering or applied mechanics. Okay, what is engineering mechanics? What is the field of engineering mechanics? One of the oldest disciplines in engineering, okay, is the field that deals with the action of forces or environmental effect on a body and how that body reacts basically to forces. That's sort of, in a broad sense, that's how engineering mechanics can be sort of presented. Within the field of engineering mechanics, there are several, of course, disciplines, that some of which you've already studied, okay? Statics, to start with, okay? Stress analysis, or the strength of materials, whatever you call that. Rigid body dynamics. Fluid mechanics. Of course, there's more than that, but these are the four major areas, right? So let's look at basically how we can differentiate these and what is significant about each of these fields and what does that have to do with mechanical vibrations, okay? Engineering mechanics, or for that matter, actually any field in engineering can be, or what you do, can be represented by this schematic diagram. Basically, you do have an input acting on a system which results in an output or response. That's all we do in studying engineering mechanics. The only difference is if this is A, B, and C, we make different assumptions, or the nature of those components are different, okay? For instance, in statics, A was simply forces or loads, either point forces, concentrated, or distributed forces. B was assumed to be a rigid body, or even simpler than that, a particle, which is a form of a rigid body, okay? So basically what you considered was, you, in statics, you were looking at the effect of forces on this rigid body. And you wanted to find, okay, what happens, or how to find the response. In statics, that response that you study were simply just forces. You had a body, and the rigid body, whatever the shape was, supported externally. This could be a truss structure, frames, machines, whatever. And you had these forces acting on that. So this was your system under the action of forces, or A, Okay? And the objective was, this applies to this rigid body, then what happens to this rigid body? Since the rigid body is rigid, cannot do anything, cannot absorb energy, cannot be deformed or anything, it simply transmitted, for the lack of a better word, transmitted that force through externally, through wherever or however it is supported. So the unknown or the response that you wanted to evaluate were, okay, what are the forces that each of these supports now will be subjected to? Or if this rigid body is made of some pieces, maybe the frame or machine or whatever that is, okay, if you have forces acting on this, what happens at the point of connections of these pieces? But in overall, the objective here was that since the system is just a useless piece, in reality it doesn't even exist. You don't have anything called rigid body, everything deforms. But given that assumption, the only thing that the input does to the system is that system just transmits the input to outside, and you want to find these, and the response is just a bunch of forces. So that was the statics, right? That's all you study, right? For one quarter, right? I'm simplifying it, right? So then you study, mechanics of materials, or stress analysis, or strength of materials, whatever you want to call that. What happened here was the input was a still bunch of forces, okay? So you were dealing with forces that act again on a body, but in this case, you have a flexible body or deformable body. We no longer assume that the body is rigid, but in fact, we looked at the reality that if a force acts on a body, body can deform, and then what happens to it is, as a result of this deformation, you, of course, end up with responses, whether internally or externally. Externally, for instance, the supports and whatnot, or internally, at every point along that structural member or the body that you consider cutting into pieces, forces are generated. Not only forces, for instance, you have a beam, you subject it to a force, at every point along that beam you cut it, there are some internal forces, shear and moments, right? Not only that, those forces also generate or result in some deformation, okay? So displacement was another result or another response due to action of these forces. You also looked at these, of course, at, you looked at it, of course, as far as the ratio of those forces per area that they act on, or the intensity of those quantities, and those intensities, you call them the stresses and the strains. So the big difference between statics and strength of material is that you look at the body that is no longer rigid. And as a result of that, forces, you create responses that depend on this system. Here, the forces generate responses that have nothing to do with basically the mass or properties that this system has. You know, in fact, you ignore the mass in the statics. There was no inertia involved, right? You ignore flexibility. Here, you do consider one aspect of the real structures, and that is their ability to deform. Again, you did not include masses. You didn't discuss anything in the strength of material as far as the inertia goes. You only consider deformation or flexibility, which we call that elasticity. Elasticity is one feature or attribute or characteristics of real structures or systems or any object you consider, okay? You also study dynamics or rigid body dynamics. I always, you know, if you ask me, consider this as being the natural extension of statics. Dynamics, honestly, has nothing to do with statics. This is the foundation for mechanics of material. This is almost in a standalone course, and I don't know why at Cal Poly we force a student to take dynamics right after this. I prefer taking this after that because it's much more relevant. But anyway, in dynamics, very similar in many respects to statics. Forces, again, I should have written here, forces were here, time independent, right? Here also, forces were time independent. So in dynamics now, you have forces that are time dependent, change with time, okay? However, as far as the system itself, you assume, again, is a rigid body. However, since the force is time dependent and this rigid body moves, it generates, of course, some acceleration or velocity, right? So the responses that we consider, okay, were time dependent forces, which in that case, very similar to statics. However, because of the effect of movement or the effect of the inertia, okay, that we consider in contrast with the other two, we also looked at what that inertia and time dependency does. So we also looked at, for instance, the acceleration, velocity, and so on, as far as responses. But nevertheless, the input to the system causes similar action, which is the force, and this rigid body really doesn't do much, except that, in this case, moves, right? So the third, or of course, category, or the area, of course, in engineering mechanics is fluids. That's, of course, more complicated, but in a way, fluid is also similar. Instead of rigid, instead of a body or a system that is predefined, fluids, of course, can take the shape in whatever environment that they're confined to, or whatever volumes they occupy. But other than that, they are the same as systems. They are systems, right? So subjected to forces, if it is a static, they generate responses that are also forces, and if there is a dynamic case, you have fluid dynamics, similar. Mathematics gets complicated because you're no longer dealing with regular, you know, differential equations, partial differential equations. We don't get into that. We're talking about just solid mechanics now. And building the case for mechanical vibration. Okay. Now, in mechanical vibrations, you have all the good stuff from all of these. That is this. The input is, of course, for the most part, is forces that are time dependent. But doesn't have to be forces. Can be any time dependent phenomenon that causes a change in the system. Can be, for instance, displacement. Okay? Forces also that you're dealing with, either they are desirable or undesirable. We're talking about forces that do something good. A jet engine does something good, moves that huge machine, right? Or the engine in a car moves the car. These are forces that are time dependent and do something desirable. But there are, of course, forces that are undesirable. You want to get rid of them. And earthquake, window, all those, you know, natural or man-made disasters that you want to prevent them or isolate them, as we use the terminology in mechanical vibrations, we call them undesirable inputs, right? But nevertheless, all of them are time dependent. Now, they act on a system, and the system is a flexible body. Completely different from dynamics, right? More like this. So now you have everything coming into picture. You have the inertia of this system. You have the ability of the system to resist the force, elasticity, right? Also, as the system deforms under the action of these forces, necessarily all the energy that goes into the system doesn't get out of the system. System has also another ability, which you haven't discussed in any of the previous courses, and that is called the energy absorption, or another terminology called damping. So the flexible body that we now consider has inertia, has elasticity, in other words, can deform under the action of load, and also has energy absorption or dissipation. Okay. Again, that energy absorption or dissipation can be a good thing and can be a bad thing. In a car, say for instance, you want to have as much energy absorption as possible, right? The bumper or whatever the mechanism is resisting the impact. It crushes. So it absorbs all the energy or most of the energy, desirably, that is input to the system, right? In an earthquake, you have a building, of course, it's an undesirable force, but you want that to be as flexible as possible, especially the joint or the base. So when earthquake comes, they actually get crushed. They deform so they can absorb energy. In the old days, they didn't think of it that way. They didn't have as much of course, advancement in understanding mechanical vibration and so on. So you remember the old cars, and of course you don't remember your dad, or your parents may remember, the bumper was made of a 100% rigid steel piece, right? So, and they thought that was the greatest thing, right? Mm-hmm. So of course, for the car it is, but not for you who is sitting, because all the energy comes as a rigid body, and rigid body transmits everything that is subjected to, right? So all that energy goes to you, so you get killed. So, but now, of course, we have other things. But anyway, so the response in this case is forces, can be other things, can be displacements, and can be the intensity of these stresses and strains. In fact, it is mechanical vibration that is really important, especially in design of mechanical systems. Because mechanical systems, in contrast to most, at least, civil engineering systems, are moving, are subjected to motion. They are subjective time-dependent forces, and they move, and forces, they are subjected to impact loads and whatnot. So it is not adequate to suffice our knowledge to what happens to the system under the assumption that the forces are static. In fact, the stresses that develop, you don't calculate them based on strength of material. You need to consider mechanical vibrations. Of course, you have done that even before taking the vibration course, believe it or not. You've taken the design, right? Machine design. So you use all these fudge factors. If you have an impact load, use the dynamic load factor of 2. We'll see where that comes from. That comes from the vibration effect. So that gives you in a nutshell, the overview of what this course is all about. And that shows how important it is, because it's really the foundation for design, or the analysis, understanding of the behavior of any mechanical or structural systems. Any questions before I go any further? No? Okay. So what's next? And believe me, you, and I'm not just saying it, this is one of the most fun and easiest courses. If you really like mechanics of materials, and you really like statics, nothing to do with dynamics. I tell you that. I don't know why that should be even a prerequisite, because everything we learn, a little bit maybe rigid body dynamics comes to help, but is for the most part, mechanical vibration is a standalone, of course, with respect to dynamics I'm talking about, knowing strength of material and being good at that is more important than remembering whatever you learn in dynamics. So when we talk about, again, going back to this, which is the foundation, as I said, okay, input, output, and system, okay? So by now we know vibration, in vibration, we have forces or displacement, right, as time dependent. This is a flexible body, and this is, of course, the response, which, as I said, can be forces, can be displacement, and can be stresses, strains, and so on, okay? In everything that we've done, we do energy and mechanics, we really need to, the ultimate goal is it possible to set up a mathematical model that has all of these elements in it? And by solving that mathematical model, which is basically a differential equation, so I would say mathematical model, is it possible to set up a mathematical model that by using that we can do whatever basically we want in terms of finding out the response of the system? So a mathematical model, which is basically a representation of the actual system, should have all the elements of the real system, meaning that it should represent the system, mass, energy absorption, elasticity. It should also have the input as well as representing the output. So that's what we want, we need to do in order to basically study mechanical vibrations. Okay. So we will see that starting tomorrow, how we do that. The good news is the only mathematical tool or knowledge that you need in this course to understand how we solve the problems or how we will be formulating mechanical vibrations is just a very innocent, ordinary differential equation of second order. That's it. Even if you don't remember that, that's okay. We will be starting from scratch, okay? Because we are not going to be solving a wide range of ordinary differential equations, but a very specific sort of a class, okay? So, especially all of you who must have, probably all of you, have taken controls, you remember there are two ways of solving a second order differential equations. One way, okay, so as far as the solution, is by experience I've come to know that you may not say that, but in all honesty, you don't like that approach, right? I might be wrong, and that is Laplace transform. How many of you, in all honesty, like to use Laplace transform? That's good, but the second approach is, of course, the direct formulation or direct integration, right? What is Laplace transform? Laplace transform is a way of integrating, right? In other words, you have a differential equation, you want to go from here to here, right? Solve the problem to find the desired quantity, right? Can be displacement or whatever, right? So how many of you know about Laplace? I'm always fascinated by the history of science and mathematics. It's fascinating. You guys get excited about Roger Clement or Tom Brady and stuff like that, right? But I really find it more fascinating when you look at these guys and what they've done for humanity, especially some of those who are really amazing in the whole history of science and mathematics. And one of them is Mr. Laplace. He did a lot of amazing things. One of which, of course, was finding a much easier way to solve complex differential equations instead of performing the integration. What he did was, he said, okay, instead of going from here to here, that's what Laplace transform is, right? Instead of using integration, or the directly going from this domain to that domain through this operator, which is a formal operator, what we will do, okay, we will first map this into a different domain, and then we do an inverse mapping or transform of that, okay? And this whole process is just a bunch of algebraic operations. Has nothing to do with integration, right? You just convert it into a bunch of fractions or whatnot, and partial fractions, and then you, boom, you get to this. It was a very clever way of doing it, because you can solve really very complicated integrations without caring about all these, differential by parts or all these stuff, and even dealing with, initial conditions and so on, become much easier. But anyway, that's one way. But talking about Mr. Laplace, that's not the only thing he did. He founded the whole field of probability. One of the people who are known to be one of the founding fathers of the field of probability, because he was a gambler. And he wanted to, find the science behind the chance. And he created the whole field. And he was also a good man. Outspoken, he always fought for justice, and he was a very active participant in the French Revolution, which is one of the most fascinating revolution in human history, much better than the American Revolution. Much, much better. In fact, Thomas Paine had quite a bit to do with that. He spent quite some time in France, right? And you know why? Because, unfortunately, we compromised. We didn't dare to abolish slavery in the Constitution, because those who we consider founding fathers, of course, in reality, some of them were not, like Mr. Jefferson, who was a slave owner himself, did not want to do that, right? But Thomas Paine, of course, wanted, and he almost lost his life. But French Revolution, slavery didn't have any place, right? And it took 11 years. They went through all kinds of phases. But anyway, getting back to Mr. Laplace, he served as an interior minister, believe it or not, of Napoleon. But he was so outspoken, and he was such a strong person, even Napoleon was afraid of him. So he spoke his mind. He didn't last long, only 2 years, and he resigned. But anyway, he was a great man. But that's Mr. Laplace. Go and study about Laplace. But so, unfortunately, we don't use that, because I don't think you like it. So we use just direct approach. So what we'll see how we do that. And of course, we are only dealing with simple, as I said, second order differential equations. So that's one thing we really need to know, okay, to be prepared for that. The second thing, as far as dealing with the mathematics in mechanical vibration and the mathematical modeling, is that we will be also dealing with the world of complex numbers. Not complex variables, but complex numbers. Okay? And I'm sure you all love it. And again, I don't need to scare you, because even if you don't remember, that's absolutely fine. We do that step by step, as you need it, just in time. Okay? But what is, you remember the fascinating world of complex numbers, right? Another great mathematician who deserves credit for that, because discovering the world of complex, basic number, mathematics, right? Was a huge contribution up until 1700s when they were going to solve, say, quadratic equation, reach anything that had to do with this, they said, it doesn't exist, so there is no solution, right? And it was until Mr. Euler, right, came up with this idea that actually this does exist. We've been ignoring it because numbers, real numbers, do not have just one dimension, but they have actually two dimensions, okay? That's what he did, right? He said, okay, each number should be represented by its both dimensions. We call them real dimension and imaginary dimension or complex dimension. So each number has two components, right, or two dimensions, so it should be written as this. Some numbers may not have it, some numbers do have it, right? For instance, if you think of number three is actually should be written like this, right? So with that introduction, he introduced the whole world, and it is important to know a little bit about complex numbers because they have a lot to do with mechanical vibrations, as you've seen it in controls. And so, like the regular algebra, complex algebra has its own similar operation. So you have the summation, okay, or subtraction. So we have two numbers, two complex numbers. Summation is basically you add up the real part and the imaginary part. That's just summation, right? The multiplication is very similar. So you have Z1 and Z2, okay? So to multiply these, you just simply consider that square root of -1 times the square root of -1, okay, is 1, right? Or in other words, I squared is 1. We call that, as you recall, this quantity, this number that they assume doesn't exist, called it I, right? So you do the multiplication, okay? You basically end up with what, x1, x2, minus y1, y2.
So I squared is -1.
I'm sorry?
I squared
is -1, right? No, I squared is -1, right? So this is I. So plus I times whatever, that would be what? As far as the multiplication goes, becomes, okay, x1, y2, plus x2, y1. And then for the division, okay, of two numbers, okay, z1, z2, okay, in order to find the outcome, right, we need to use the concept of equality in complex numbers. In other words, if a number z1 is equal to z2, the real part of 1 is equal to the real part of 2, and the imaginary part is equal to the imaginary part of 2. So you assume z that you want to find is x, something like x plus iy. So if you multiply z times z2 and equate that to z1, you can find z. If you have z1 and z2, you can find z. And if you try to do that, means actually that you end up with the outcome would be k, the sum of the division of the two will, okay, I see if I don't want to go through all the algebraic operation, it comes out to be a something very, of course, not so nice. X1, X2 plus Y1, Y2 plus I times Y1, X2 plus X1, Y2 divided by X1 squared plus Y1 squared. That would be the summation. But of course, this is not such a nice, you know, looking, expression. So Mr. Euler actually thought of something else, which makes the life even a lot more easier. He said, well, there is another way to look at an analogy of real numbers and, in fact, vectors. Or if you have a basic complex numbers, why don't you also establish an analogy with the polar coordinates? So if you call this distance from the origin to this point, which is a number as r, and this is theta, you can see that x becomes r cosine theta, and y becomes r sine theta. So z can be written as r cosine theta plus I sine theta. And if you write it as such, these operations become a lot more easier. In fact, the expression of z1 times z2 and so forth, or z to the n, becomes r to the n cosine of n theta plus I sine n theta, and so on. Okay? So these are the things that I don't want to go through that. You will, we don't really, may not even use all of that, but it's good to know that we will be dealing with complex numbers. There are, of course, again, some other things that we will just skip over all the derivation part, but it is good to know, and that is, again, Mr. Euler, by looking at the expansion, Taylor expansion of sine theta and cosine theta, and substituting for theta in those expansions, substituting theta with I theta, could demonstrate that z can be also written as r to the e to the I theta, which is another way of representing complex numbers. And the other sort of quantity that you need in dealing with complex number, which is just a terminology or a definition, is a concept of complex conjugate. If you have two numbers that are symmetric with respect to the real axis, we call this the conjugate of z1, and we replace, show it like that, or z1 asterisk is x minus I, y. So in a nutshell, to be honest, that's all we really need to know. And again, by no means do I mean to scare you, just to show you that what kind of mathematics we may be using, not to the fullest scale, but that's all we will be needing to deal with mechanical vibrations. So the thing that, two things that we take from here is that studying mechanical vibration is studying a flexible body under the action of forces. And we will talk about the system itself, how we will model the system, and then how to find the response. In order to find the response, we'll be using these mathematical theories. And that's it. So hopefully, starting tomorrow, we'll start step by step from introducing the system, formulating it, and then talking about the solution. Thank you very much, and thank you.